Hello, everybody. So I'm going to start with talking about the Big Bang. Assuming that we accept the Big Bang as the origin of the universe, then we've got the universe starting about 14 billion years ago. And after, and everything is contained in this tiny little space, and it's getting bigger and bigger. And after about 3 minutes, the universe is made of hydrogen and helium and nothing else. And the problem with that is that we don't contain much hydrogen and helium. And so we need to think about where other elements come from. So in the universe, hydrogen is by far the most abundant thing. It's 75% by mass, 93% by number of atoms. It's really abundant, but in terms of planets and life, it's not so abundant. So let's talk about what we're made of. Well, we are made of only 10% hydrogen. We're mostly oxygen, quite a lot of carbon. We actually contain a little bit of just about everything. In varying components, but mostly we're oxygen and carbon. And so we need to know where that comes from. And we don't have that stuff at the beginning of the universe, so we have to know where it was made. Okay, so where do those elements come from? Well, first of all, let's talk about what an element is, just to make sure everybody understands this. So when we have an element, we're talking about atoms. Atoms are these tiny little things that have a core that is minuscule, made of protons and neutrons, and then it has electrons around it. In terms of what makes something a specific element, it's actually to do with the number of protons. When an atom is neutral, like it is in, for most of the time in our bodies and in the stuff around you, then the number of electrons matches the number of protons. But the number of electrons doesn't matter for what makes an element. What matters is the protons. Neutrons just give mass. They also make things more stable, but they're not contributing to whether it's an, a specific atom. So atoms come in different sizes. If you include the electrons, they're about 10 to the minus 10 meters. So that's a 10 billionth of a meter across. It's a tiny space. But actually, most of that is space. That's where the electrons are. And in fact, it's even smaller than that. It is about a 10 billion, million billionth or quadrillionth of a meter in size. And that's where the protons are. And like I say, what really matters is the number of protons. So the number of protons tells you what elements you've got. So going back to our Big Bang, we've got hydrogen and helium. So hydrogen has one proton. Helium has two protons. They can have different numbers of neutrons. I'll get into that later. Lithium, which we make a little bit of in the Big Bang, has three protons, and so on. But we need to be making more stuff. And the problem is that when you're making this, you've got these protons and you want them to stick together, and they don't stick together very well because they have an electric charge. So they have an electric charge, and when you try to push them together, they repel. If you've ever played around with magnets, if you've got a north pole and a south pole together, they stick together. But if you try to stick two north poles together, they push apart. My kids enjoy doing this with the train set in Barnes & Noble that have magnetic things. And you push them together and they push apart. The same thing happens with your protons. So you've got a proton and another proton, and you try bringing them together and you can't, and so when you pull them apart, when they push together, they're going to push apart. And so they have to be both close together and moving really fast in order to get together. And so as the universe expands, soon it's too low density and too cool, it's not moving fast enough, and so you don't make any more heavy elements. And so we have to think about how elements are made. Well, let's start with what's happening inside of the early universe. You've got here, and I'm going to try to use my cursor. So here I've got a hydrogen and another hydrogen. So that's just a proton, okay? And stick them together, you get a proton here, and also one of them throws out an electron, and it ends up having a neutron. So what you've done, actually, it's a negative electron. It's an anti-electron, so it's getting rid of the positive charge, it becomes neutral. And so it's doing a nuclear reaction. It's decaying. It's throwing out this charged particle. And then you take this thing, and this is still hydrogen because it still only has one proton, but now it has a neutron. You stick on another proton, and it sticks together. Now you've got two, and now you've got two. It's a helium, okay? And then you actually stick two of those together because the most stable form of helium has two neutrons, okay? So this is basically what happens in the early universe. Hydrogens are just one proton, you can stick them together. But then it gets harder to bring in the next one, because now you've got two positive charges, and it's even harder to bring another charge together. And so it basically is stopped from doing it because the universe is spreading out too much and there isn't enough energy. So this is what's going on in the early universe. This is a slightly different schematic of the same thing. So I've got two protons, you stick them together, one of them converts by throwing out an anti-electron, converts into a neutron, and then you add another one, and eventually you end up with this helium with two neutrons, which is the standard helium. You've also got some neutrons floating around, so you can stick some neutrons in, and they're not going to be repelled because they're neutral, so you don't get the repulsion. You still need to have high density to get them to collide. And you've also, if you've got some helium, you can add in another proton, and that will give you lithium. And so this is basically how we're doing this. But what's stopping it from making bigger elements is this electric propulsion. It's hard to stick heavier, more and more massive things together because the positive charge is getting stronger and stronger. And it's like you've got bigger and bigger magnets, and as you try to pull them together, they're getting pushed apart more strongly. And so we've got like charges repelling. So this is just like the magnetic repulsion, and it's bigger for higher charges. And so the nuclei are all positively charged, and so they push apart. And so in order to make heavier elements, you need to have both high temperatures. Temperature is just a measure of how much energy you've got. And so at high temperatures, the atoms are moving fast. So all of the molecules in the atmosphere around you are moving at a speed that has to do with the temperature in the room. Well, likewise with your early universe, the particles are moving with a speed that is to do with the temperature. So you need them to move at high speed to hit each other, and you need high densities to hit each other. So the universe has started, and it's now expanded, and it's no longer hot enough or dense enough to do fusion. So where do we make it happen? Well, we're going to make this happen inside stars. Inside a star is where you have high temperatures and high densities, and you can make this happen. So when we talk about making this happen, what we're doing is fusion. It is nuclear fusion. We're sticking hydrogens together. We're taking hydrogen fusion, and this is also how a hydrogen bomb works. You're sticking hydrogen atoms, so protons together, and releasing energy as a result. And actually, this uses the most famous equation in the universe. Even people who have done no science at all have usually heard of the equation E equals mc squared. They don't necessarily know what it means, but they've heard of it. And what it means is that for any mass that you have an equivalent energy. So I have an energy here that relates to a mass and the speed of light. So if I've got a certain mass, let's say I was to convert myself, my mass, into an energy, I would take my mass, and I'm not going to tell you what my mass is, and I would multiply it by the speed of light squared, and that would give me the total amount of energy that I would turn into if I was to suddenly become energy. And just as an aside, this is why the transporter beam in Star Trek is a problem, because the amount of energy that you would make in converting a human body into an energy stream is rather a lot. But putting that aside, what we do when we take hydrogens, we've basically got four hydrogen atoms. Two of them get converted into neutrons, but we end up with a helium. And what happens is that that helium, which has got two protons and two neutrons, is lower in mass than the four hydrogens that went in. And it's kind of like a binding energy. You can think of it as being you've stuck them together, and now to make them fall apart again, you have to give that energy back to make it fall apart. And so you're binding these things together, but that energy's gone off, and that energy is released as light. It is energy, and it is what is fueling the sun. And just to give you an idea of how much of this is made, it only converts less than 1% of the mass into energy. So to maintain the brightness of the sun, the amount of energy it puts out every second, we have to convert 600 billion kilograms of hydrogen into helium every second. Luckily, the sun has a lot more mass than that, and so it's not going to run out anytime soon. Eventually it will, but not in our lifetimes, so we don't need to worry about that. So for most of their lives, stars are like the sun, and they're doing the same thing that happened in the early universe. They're taking protons and sticking them together to make two protons stuck together, and so you've got hydrogen turning into helium. So we still don't have any heavy elements. We've only made hydrogen and helium. So we have to think about what happens next. Now, I'm not going to go into all the details. I have follow-up stuff that people can look at if they'd like to. But basically, when you run out of hydrogen in the core, the star will go through some changes, and eventually it gets hotter and denser so that it can do the next step. So you need to think of it as being, to get hydrogens to stick together, you need to have high density and a temperature of about 10 to 15 million Kelvin, so 30 million Fahrenheit. And you can't get things heavier than that, more massive than that to stick together. But once it's dying, it gets hotter and gets more dense, so it's collapsing in and getting hotter, and that allows it to get to a high enough temperature to stick heliums together. And so what happens with helium, so now instead of fusing hydrogens, we're fusing heliums. And this is at about 100,000 Kelvin, so approximately 200 million Fahrenheit. And it's now sticking together. So here we've got a helium atom and another helium atom and another helium atom, and they stick together and they make carbon. And they release energy. Again, the carbon atom has less mass than the four of these stuck together. It's a binding energy. We call this the triple alpha process because the helium nucleus is actually the alpha particle that we have in radiation. Radiation is usually thought of, nuclear radiation is thought of as alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. And the alpha particles are these heliums, so we call it the triple alpha process. Okay, so when we do that, we've now made a carbon that's made up of these four, and we can keep adding them. So here I've got a carbon 12, I add another helium, I get oxygen. I've got an oxygen atom, I add another helium, I get neon. I've got a neon atom, I add another helium, I get magnesium, and so on. And you can see here that you can keep doing this until you get to nickel 56. Nickel 56 isn't stable, so it actually decays to make iron 56. So it goes through a radioactive process where it's not stable, so it converts some of its neutrons into protons and becomes, actually some of its protons into neutrons and becomes iron. Okay, so this is how we're building them up. Actually, stars like the Sun don't do this. They can do this step of making carbon 12, and they can do this step of adding another helium, but then they're not hot enough in the core to be able to make these heavier elements directly. And so what's actually going on is, this is what the structure of the star is like, and it's actually going to be making these heavy elements in this region here, where you've got heliums sticking together to make carbon, and you can add some other heliums on. And then they actually, it's convection, so there's currents of material that's flowing from here up to the surface, and then these stars pulsate and throw it out. So even though the nuclear process is happening deep inside the star, the products of those nuclear reactions get to the surface and go off into space. These stars don't need to explode. It's a myth that you have to explode stars to get heavy elements in. And so we're getting this stuff thrown out, and it takes about a million years or so, it depends on the type of star, to get this new material out into space. They make a lot of carbon. In fact, the majority of carbon in your body came from these sorts of stars, stars like the Sun, that lived and died before the solar system existed, and that material got thrown into space and became part of this next solar system. And they make lots of carbon and actually a lot of the oxygen, but they can't make the heavier elements, so we still can't make things up to iron this way. Now, if you've got a higher mass star, then it can do more, and this has to do with the temperature and the density inside. So if it's a higher mass star, it can get carbons and stick carbons together. And when you stick carbons together, then you get oxygens and other things made. And then you stick oxygens together and you can make more things. And then you stick neons together and you make more things. And so basically you can just keep on fusing different elements up to making iron. Now, iron is only the 26th element. We have a lot more elements than that. So we can make all of these stars just by sticking other atoms together by fusion and getting them more and more tightly bound, so you get energy out. But once you get to iron, you don't get energy out, so you can't make them the same way. Just to kind of get into this idea, what this diagram is showing, this here is basically the amount of energy that's lost. You can think of it as being, here I have a hydrogen, and when I make my helium, there's this amount of energy that was lost in making the helium, so that's what you have to give back to make it fall apart. And so, in general, as you go up in elements, you go down in the amount of energy. So this is how much energy you have to put in to break it apart again. But once you get to iron, this is the most stable element. This is where the most energy has been lost per thing, proton and neutron, inside the element. And so you can't keep adding things and gaining energy. It gets less stable. And so as you add things, it actually takes energy to push it in, and it's less stable. So elements from hydrogen all the way to iron become more stable by getting bigger, whereas elements bigger than iron get more stable by getting smaller. And so it's fusion that makes energy up to iron, and it's fission, falling apart of atoms, that makes energy beyond iron. And so you can make things up to iron, and you can make things more than iron, you can add in more elements, but it will cost you. You no longer make energy by doing it. And so most stars don't do this very efficiently, because they'll die very quickly. In fact, they do. But what happens in these higher mass stars is they go through this process of sticking things together, and once they get to iron, they have no way of making more energy, and they die in a dramatic way by exploding. So how do we make more massive elements? Well, actually, we do it in a way that most people don't think about. So we've got iron, it's got 26 protons, and we can make it by fusion. But we need to make, you know, even in ours, there will be the occasional uranium atom. All these stable elements on the Earth go up to 92 protons. So we've got a whole bunch of other elements we have to make. And we have to make them in a way that's not sticking atoms together. And we do it by adding neutrons. So now what you've got is, let's say you've got a carbon-12. Carbon-12 is the most common isotope. And by isotope, I mean you can have carbon with 6 neutrons, but it can also have 7 neutrons. It can have 8 neutrons. As you add in neutrons, it gets less stable. And so we can also create neutrons. So as you are making heavy elements, sometimes neutrons will get thrown out of the atom. So here, if I've got a carbon with an extra neutron, actually the oxygen 16, which has 8 protons and 8 neutrons, that is the most stable. And so sometimes it'll throw out a neutron. And so you'll have these free neutrons floating around, and they can get added without costing energy because they are not charged, so you don't get repulsion. So as long as you've got a high density, so they actually hit each other, then you can get neutrons added into other atoms. And so once you've got some neutrons available, you can just keep adding them in. And there are two ways this can happen. You can either add lots and lots of neutrons in so that you just got silly atoms. You've got, say, a carbon that instead of having 6 neutrons has 20 neutrons, and it's completely unstable, and now it's going to decay into something else. Or you can add something where you've got a carbon, and it's carbon-12, and you add a neutron, and carbon-13 is still stable. So you add another neutron. Carbon-14 is not stable. It takes a few thousand years to decay on average, so it waits, so you've got 1,000 years between adding the next one. And so now you've got a nitrogen, and you add in another neutron. So you've got different pathways to making heavy elements. And so the R process is just, you add in as many neutrons as you can until it's so unstable that it will just decay instantaneously. And to get this, you have to have really high densities of neutrons. So it happens in these high mass stars where they have lots of reactions that can make neutrons. And so this is the things that explode. But the slow process, so the R process is the rapid process. We're very, you know, creative in our naming in astrophysics. And the S process is the slow process. And in this case, so you add in a neutron, and then if it can decay, it will. And then you add in another neutron, and if it can decay, it will. And so you follow a very different path to making different elements. So to give you an example, there's a cobalt that you can make that has like 50 neutrons more than it should have. And as those neutrons convert into protons, you create a different set of elements. Whereas if you're starting from, say, carbon and adding a neutron, it will make a different set of elements and isotopes. And so for these slow decays, you actually are only adding a proton every, you know, 1,000 or 10,000 years. So you actually need to have fairly low densities. And you have to have long time scales. So this is what happens in these low mass stars like the Sun. And so we've got elements that, you know, we know have to come from supernovae. So things that are more massive than lead, so uranium, strontium, thorium, they have to be formed inside stars with supernova. But things like zirconium, for instance, are predominantly made in stars that don't explode. So we've got all these different ways that we make stars. And what happens is that you've got both low-mass stars and high-mass stars, they're making elements. The high-mass stars explode, the low-mass stars get the stuff to the surface and then kind of slough it off slowly over a million years. Then that material goes off into space and forms the next generation of stars and planets. And so all of the material in us, except for the hydrogen, was formed inside of stars and formed some sort of dust on the way out of the stars, and so therefore we are all stardust. And I will stop there and answer questions.
Are these net reactions? I mean, is there a dynamic sort of nuclear stoichiometry where you're having neutron capture and loss? So when you have a certain process, are you just saying that these things are happening as a net effect?
Right. So when I presented it very simply, when you stick, let's say you've got two carbons, even in fusion, when you stick two carbons together, if you just stick them together, then you should end up with a magnesium. But depending on the exact temperature and the exact energy of the collision, you might get a neutron thrown out, you might get a helium and an oxygen. There's all sorts of pathways. So it depends on the precise conditions as to exactly what comes out. But yes, you've got all of it going on at once.
So is there, I guess, like a rough estimate of the proportion of all the stars that would be low mass and the proportion that would be high mass?
Let me just make sure I understand the question. This is about what types of stars make what elements?
No, it's just in general, the kinds of stars. So if we're looking at all the stars, and then we have high mass stars and low mass, and I just was wondering.
Okay, so there are, it's easier to make a low mass star than a high mass star. So if we do a census, there are always, so the sun is pretty average. There are lots more lower mass stars, but they make less heavy elements. And as you go up in mass, you make more heavy elements. And then you've got, but you go down in numbers a lot. And it's power law. So you actually go down by factors of, orders of magnitude as you go up in mass. So there are a lot less 10 solar mass stars than there are one solar mass stars. And there are a lot more 10th of a solar mass stars than there are one solar mass stars. So that's, but the high mass stars also die much more quickly. They're using their fuel up much more quickly. So even though they're more massive, they die very fast. So you have to kind of factor that in too.
Okay, I think we might stop there so that we have time for Dr. Miller to present. So I'm sure that Angela would be available to answer questions or to talk to the media. Is that right, Angela?
When would you like me to be available?
Well, if you would like to, you could share an email address, or I know how to reach you if you want to put people.
My email address is speckan, that's speckan, at missouri.edu. You can email me. I also want to make a little plug for, there's an event coming up that has to do with the sun in 571 days, I think. August 21st next year, 2017, there will be a total solar eclipse that crosses the U.S. and goes over Columbia. So I'm also happy to talk about that ad nauseum.
Yes. What's the date of that again?
August 21st, 2017.
August 21st.
And it runs from Oregon to South Carolina. We're right in the middle of the path in Columbia.
Yeah, this is going to be a big deal. So this is a good story for someone to get on. And Angela is the one to talk to about it. And you can also find her on Twitter at Stardust Speck.
That's me.
Yep. Sounds good. All right. Well, thank you so much. Thanks, Angela.